If you can say anything about Jesus in the Gospel of Mark, it's that he's not afraid of breaking boundaries. Jesus' first sermon gets right to the point. The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near, he says to all who will listen. The greatest boundary, the one between heaven and earth, between God's way of doing things and the human way, has been broken. The kingdom has come near, Jesus says, and every other boundary must fall in its wake. One of his very first miracles, then, is to reach out and touch a leper, a man whose illness renders him untouchable, beyond the bounds of normal human contact. One boundary falls. Soon he heals a man with a deformed hand on the Sabbath, disobeying a legalistic order for the day of rest. Is it lawful to do good or to do harm on the Sabbath? He says to those who object, to save life or to kill. Another boundary begins to crumble. A woman who has been bleeding for 12 years, suffering in isolation as an outsider, touches Jesus' garment and finds that the bleeding stops. Daughter, he says in front of everyone, just to be sure they get the message that this is no outsider, but part of the family. Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease. Another boundary starts to crack. That's just the first few chapters of the book. You get the idea pretty quickly that Jesus is here to knock down every barrier humans build to separate themselves from one another and from God. He has no patience for divisions and borders. The kingdom of God has come near, and every other boundary must fall in its wake. Which is part of what makes today's gospel reading so disturbing. After all the boundary breaking he has done already, after his forceful proclamation of the kingdom of God that has come near in him, Jesus bumps into an age-old boundary and does nothing to knock it down. He enforces it, in fact. The woman who throws herself at Jesus' feet is a Gentile. She's come looking for this out-of-town prophet and healer because her daughter is sick with an unclean spirit. Probably a pretty good way to talk about an illness you can't understand and don't know what else to do about. Her daughter is sick and she'll do anything to make her well. She begs Jesus for help, but she's a Gentile. She's outside the boundary of the Jewish family, and Jesus treats her that way. Let the children be fed first, for it's not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs, he says. The power I have is for the children of Israel, not for you animals. That's what he says. I'm here for them, not for you. There's not enough to go around. The boundary stays. We can't escape the talk of boundaries today. Whether it's images of boats adrift in the Mediterranean, or buses and trains packed with people clutching plastic bags filled with their belongings, boundaries are the topic right now. Who will take in these people with nowhere to go? Where are they welcome? What boundaries will stand and what will fall? Ban Ki-moon said this last week that we are not facing a crisis of numbers. We're facing a crisis of solidarity. A tear in the human fabric, a sense that we're not really in this together, a boundary between us and them. So Jesus, the great boundary breaker, stands guard at the border between Jew and Gentile in this reading. People have tried to get him off the hook for centuries. He's not really calling her a dog, some have insisted. He's calling her a puppy. It's supposed to be cute. Others have said he is just testing her, trying to see how strong her faith really is. But I don't think we can rescue Jesus from this. If we take the reading at face value, I think it's the story of Jesus coming up against what he saw as the limits of God's grace, and of a woman who isn't afraid to challenge those limits. "Sir, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs," she says back to him. It is a deeply courageous thing to do. A woman speaking back to a man in this time and culture, and to a famed healer and teacher at that. There is enough to go around, she says. I know there is. And we are seeing this happening today, aren't we? We're seeing a woman in Iceland who heard the news that her government would take in only 50 refugees, responding by starting a forum online that quickly had secured places for thousands of people in individual homes. We're seeing people showing up at train stations with meals and toys and signs that say, "Welcome." We're seeing churches opening their doors and speaking up with the clear voice of the gospel that says we must welcome those in need, no matter how different they are from us. We're seeing courageous people stand up and say, in one way or another, "There is enough to go around. I know there is." The woman at Jesus' feet said those words, emboldened no doubt by her daughter's sickness. And something happened in Jesus. The story doesn't say much about it, but something in this woman's words spoke to him. Maybe her courage, maybe her determination, maybe her ordinariness, the fact that all mothers with sick children are really the same. No matter what language they speak, or where they come from, or what name they use for God. Whatever it was, something crumbled inside Jesus. An age-old boundary between those inside and those outside fell. And out came the words, "For saying that, you may go. The demon has left your daughter." The conversation changed him. He wouldn't be the same after that encounter, and neither would those who follow him. The kingdom of God has come near, and every boundary must fall in its wake. We know this is right. We know it. But what can we do? A community made up largely of foreigners here in Geneva. The latest figures I've seen say that more than 322,000 refugees and migrants have arrived in Europe since the beginning of the year. What can we possibly do? 10 years ago, the writer Annie Dillard was asked to write an essay following the tsunami in the Indian Ocean that killed thousands upon thousands of people, leaving many well-meaning others feeling totally helpless. And what she wrote then feels so appropriate now. These are her words. A newspaper headline said, "Head-spinning numbers cause minds to go slack." But surely we agree that our minds must not go slack. Neither must our hands. We, the living, now enter the surf to form a human boom, like a log boom. We try to encircle and enclose and bring in and save. You know what a log boom is? I had to look this up to be sure. But it's a structure made to catch logs floating down a river, to be sure they don't float away off course, to be sure they go where they're supposed to. We must create a human boom, she says. We must catch those who are afloat. We do not go slack, she says. We secure the boom. We hold tight to other hands in the water. We save and rescue as many as we can, whether we can see the people flail in front of us or not. I don't know just how we do this from where we sit. We are not all able to offer space and a spare bed. We are not all able to show up at a train station with a meal and a welcome sign. But we are all able to keep our hearts open. We are all able to pray. Maybe that means allowing these stories to break our hearts a little. Maybe it means allowing the numbers to make us uncomfortable. Maybe it means staying vulnerable to these stories that are human and tragic and undoubtedly close to God's heart. I don't know just what we can do to help. Maybe concrete tasks will emerge for our community with time. I don't know just what we can do, but I know we must do this. Be opened, Jesus said, and the man could hear. And that is the word for us today. For our ears, our minds, our hearts. Be opened. Be open to the stories of others. Be opened to the prophetic voices reminding us that there is enough to go around. Be open to the ways we may be called on to help. Be opened to the new thing our God may be doing. Surely our minds must not go slack, neither must our hands. Surely we must stay open to the gospel itself, to the good news of Jesus. The kingdom of God has come near, and every other boundary must fall in its wake. Amen.